Hallelujah, hallelujah,
Hallelujah,
hallelujah.
hallelujah.
Hallelujah and Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat Shalom.
Shalom.
Marcia, are you online for opening prayer?
Shabbat Shalom, Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom.
Hallelujah, praise hallelujah. To God. Thank you. Glory to God. Father, we thank you for your love and kindness. We bless your holy name. You are so worthy of all the praise, glory, and honor, Father. We worship you, Father. Thou art mighty. Thou art wonderful. Our counselor, our everything, our all in all. Oh, Adonai, blessed is your name. Blessed is your name. Praise be to God. Wonderful Savior. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you for this Shabbat. We just thank you for being with us always, always being with us, your children. And we are so grateful, Father God, that you are with us, that you love us, that you care for us, Father, that you have us in the palm of your hands. Father, thank you for this day, Lord. We ask you, Father God, to continually keep us, Lord, and direct our steps and guide us, Lord, in your word and in your way, Father. Lord, forgive us if there's anything that we have done or said, anything, Father God, since, Father God, knowingly or unknowingly, O God. Forgive us, O God, Father, for we are sorry and we just want to walk in your way and to serve you and to do all that you have called us to do, Father God. Bless our pastor. Take care of her, Father God. Keep her, Father God. Continually provide for her, O God. And fill her, Father God, with your word, with your insight for us, O God, as we will hear and obey, Father God, as you instruct us, Father God. Thank you for taking care of us, O God. Thank you for this day, O God. We, Father God, rejoice in your presence. Rejoice in you. And give hallowed be thy name to your name, Father God. Thank you for your goodness. Thank you for taking care of my brothers and sisters, my yeshiva family, Father God, our families, Lord God. Oh God, we ask you, Lord God, Father God, to continually show us what to do, Lord, in such a time as this, as now, oh God, we pray, oh God, for the country that is going through wars and things, Father God, that they can't even handle, Father God. Be with them, oh God. Watch over them, oh God, Lord. Direct them, oh God. And Father God, fight for them, oh God, and be with their families and those, Father God, who are all over and spread thin, Father. I thank you, God, that you provide all that in me. We pray for Israel, oh God, Daddy God. We pray for the peace and the shalom of Israel. We pray that all of Israel will come to serve you, God, and to know you, oh God. Father, thank you for your loving kindness. In Yeshua's name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Shabbat Shalom. This is Connie from Las Vegas. I'll be reading Matthew 16, chapter 13 through 19. And when Yeshua came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, "Whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" And they said, "Some say that thou art John the Baptist, some Elias, and other Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." He said unto them, "But whom say ye that I am?" And Simon Peter answered and said, "Thou art the Messiah, the Son of the living Elohim." And Yeshua answered and said unto him, "Blessed art thou, Simon or Jonah, for the flesh and blood have not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. And I say also unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall bound in heaven, and whosoever thou shalt loose on earth shall loose in heaven." Shabbat Shalom. Miriam?
Shabbat Shalom. Shabbat Shalom. This is Miriam from Spring Hill, Florida. I will continue the reading from verses 20 through 28. Then charged he his disciples that they should tell no man that he was Yeshua HaMashiach. From that time forth began Yeshua to show unto his disciples how that he must go unto Jerusalem and suffer many things of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed and be raised again the third day. Then Peter took him and began to rebuke him, saying, be it far from thee, Lord, this shall not be unto thee. But he turned and said unto Peter, Get thee behind me, Satan, thou art an offense unto me, for thou savorest not the things that be of God, but those that be of men. Then Yeshua said unto his disciples, If any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. For what is a man profited if he has gained the whole world and lose his own soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? For the Son of Man shall come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and then he shall reward every man according to his works. Verily I say unto you, there be some standing here which shall not taste of death till they see the Son of Man come in his kingdom. Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom. This is Katrina from North Carolina. I'll be reading Matthew 20, 17 through 19. And Yeshua going up to Jerusalem, took a 12 disciples apart in the way and said unto them, Behold, we go up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man shall be betrayed unto the chief of priests and unto the scribes, and they shall condemn him to death. And they say, Deliver him to the Gentiles to mock and to scourge and to crucify him. And the third day he shall rise again. Shabbat Shalom. Grace?
Shabbat Shalom. This is Grace from Spring Hill, Florida. I'll be reading Mark 5:25-34. And a certain woman, which had an issue of blood 12 years, and had suffered many things of many physicians, and had sent all that she had, and was nothing better, but rather grew worse. When she had heard of Yeshua, came in the press behind and touched his garment. For she said, If I may touch but his clothes, I shall be whole. And straightway the fountain of her blood was dried up. She felt in her body that she was healed of the plague. And Yeshua, immediately knowing in himself that virtue had gone out of him, turned him about in the press and said, Who touched my clothes? And the disciples said unto him, Thou seest the multitude thronging thee, and sayest thou, Who touched me? And he looked around about to see her that had done this thing. But the woman, fearing and trembling, knowing what was done in her, came and fell down before him and told him all the truth. And he said unto her, Daughter, thy faith has made thee whole. Go in peace and be whole of thy plague. Shabbat Shalom. Renee?
Hallelujah. Shabbat Shalom. This is Renee from North Carolina. I'll be reading 2 Kings, the 7th chapter, verses 1 through 20. And Elijah replied, Hear the word of Yahweh. Thus saith Yahweh, This time tomorrow, a sea of choice flour shall sell for a shekel at the gate of Samaria, and two seas of barley for a shekel. The aide on whose arm the king was leaning spoke up and said to the man of Elohim, Even if Yahweh were to make windows in the sky, could this come to pass? And he retorted, You shall see it with your own eyes, but you shall not eat of it. There were four men, lepers, outside the gate. They said to one another, Why should we sit here waiting for death? If we decide to go into the town, what with the famine in the town, we shall die there. And if we just sit here, still we die. Come, Let us desert to the Armenian camp. If they let us live, we shall live, and if they put us to death, we shall but die. They set out at twilight for the Armenian camp, but when they came to the edge of the Armenian camp, there was no one there. For Adonai had caused the Armenian camp to hear a sound of chariots, a sound of horses, the din of a huge army. They said to one another, "The king of Israel must have hired the kings of the Hittites and the kings of Mizraim to attack us." And they fled headlong in the twilight, abandoning their tents and horses and asses, the entire camp, just as it was, as they fled for their lives. When those lepers came to the edge of the camp, they went into one of the tents and ate and drank. Then they carried off silver and gold and clothing from there and buried it. They came back and went into another tent, and they carried off what was there and buried it. Then they said to one another, "We are not doing right. This is a day of good news, and we are keeping silent. If we wait until the light of morning, we shall incur guilt. Come, let us go and inform the king's palace." They went and called out to the gatekeepers of the city and told them, "We have been to the Armenian camp. There is not a soul there, nor any human sound, but the horses are tethered and the asses are tethered and the tents are undisturbed." The gatekeepers called out, and the news was passed on to the king's palace. The king rose in the night and said to his courtiers, "I will tell you what the Armenians have done to us. They know we are starving. So they have gone out of camp and hidden in the fields, thinking, when they come out of the town, we will take them alive and get into the town." But one of the courtiers spoke up, "Let a few of the remaining horses that are still here be taken. They are like those that are left here of the whole multitude of Israel. Out of the whole multitude of Israel, they have perished. And let us send and find out." They took two teams of horses, and the king sent them after the Armenian army, saying, "Go and find out." They followed them as far as the Jordan and found the entire road full of clothing and gear, which the Armenians had thrown away in their haste. And the messengers returned and told the king. The people then went out and plundered the Armenian camp. So a seed of choice flour sold for a shekel and two seeds of barley for a shekel, as Yahweh had spoken. Now the king had put the aide on whose arm he leaned in charge of the gate, and he was trampled to death in the gate by the people, just as the man of Elohim had spoken, as he had spoken when the king came down to him. For when the man of Elohim said to the king, "This time tomorrow, two seeds of barley shall sell at the gate of Samaria for a shekel, and a seed of choice flour for a shekel," the aide answered the man of Elohim and said, "Even if Yahweh made windows in the sky, could this come to pass?" And he retorted, "You shall see it with your own eyes, but you shall not eat of it." That is exactly what happened to him. The people trampled him to death in the gate. Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom. You are redeemed from the curse through the blood of Yeshua. You are the seed of Abraham, and I have redeemed you from the curse through the blood of my son Yeshua. I have given you blessing instead of cursing and life instead of death. I will break and release you from all generational curses and iniquities that came as a result of the sins of your ancestors. I have broken all curses of witchcraft, sorcery, and divination against you through the power of my son. I will break and rebuke all curses of sickness and infirmity in my son's name. You have been redeemed. You are set free. We choose blessing instead of cursing and life instead of death. The blood of Yeshua HaMashiach has redeemed us from the curse. No longer will we fear the curse of the enemy, for we have been set free by the power of Yeshua HaMashiach. Amen. Break the curse of witchcraft and sorcery. My child, I have loved you with an everlasting love, and because I love you, I have turned the curses of witchcraft and sorcery from the enemy into a blessing for you. I will help you according to my mercy, that you may know that it was by my hand that I have blessed what the enemy has cursed in your life. I will stand at your right hand and save you from those who condemn you. You will be a blessing to those among you whom you were cursed. I am determined to do good to you and your household. Do not fear, but speak the truth to your neighbor and give truth, justice, and peace to all you meet. Father, in your name, we break and release ourselves from all spoken curses and negative words spoken against us by others, and we bless them. No evil curses of witchcraft or sorcery will have any effect upon our lives, for you have broken the curse and have turned it into a blessing for our lives through your precious son, Yeshua. Amen.
Lena, you able to?
Shalom, everybody. Can you hear me?
Yeah, kind of.
I need to turn up. Oh, can you hear me?
Yeah, so we can hear you.
Very low.
But it's stopped.
This is Lena from St. Petersburg. I'll be reading portion summary and this week in Bible history. Portion summary. The 28th greeting from the Torah is Metzora, a word that means leper. The word appears in the second verse of the reading, which says, "This shall be the law of the leper in the day of his cleansing." Leviticus 14, verses 2. Leviticus 14 spells out the complex purification rituals for the cleansing of a leper in a leprous home. Leviticus 15 briefly covers the law regarding ritual unfitness stemming from bodily emissions. Except in biblical calendar leap years, Metzora is read together with the previous Torah portion, Tezria, on the same Sabbath. This week in Bible history, first red heifer prepared, Nisan 2, 1312 BCE. On the 2nd of Nisan, one day after the inauguration of the tabernacle, Moses prepared the very first red heifer in order to ritually purify the Jewish nation in preparation for the bringing of the Paschal lamp. Lamb in the newly erected sanctuary. Leviticus Levites inducted, Nisan 3, 1312 BCE. Following the procedure God prescribed in Numbers chapter 8, verses 5 through 22, Moses inducted the Levites into tabernacle service. The induction ceremony included sprinkling them with the ashes of the red heifer, which was prepared the day beforehand. Spies to Jericho, Nisan 5, 1273 BCE. 2 days before the conclusion of the 30-day mourning period, following the passing of Moses on Adar 7, see Jewish history for the 7th of Nisan, Joshua dispatched two scouts, Caleb and Pinchas, across the Jordan River to Jericho, to gather intelligence in preparation of the Israelite battle with the first city in their conquest of the Holy Land. In Jericho, they were assisted and hidden by Rahab, a woman who lived inside the city wall. Rahab later married Joshua. Jews prepared to enter Canaan, Nisan 7, 1273 BCE. The Jewish nation mourned for 30 days following the passing of Moses. During this time, Joshua, the new leader of the Jewish nation, sent scouts to spy on the land of Canaan. See Jewish history for the 5th of Nisan. On the 7th of Nisan, the first day after the mourning period came to an end, Joshua instructed the Jews to stock up on provisions and prepared themselves to cross the Jordan River and begin the conquest of the Promised Land. This was the first time Joshua addressed the nation, and they unconditionally accepted him as their new leader. War of Egyptian firstborn, Nisan 8, 1313 BCE. On the Sabbath before the Exodus, Nisan 10th on that year, the firstborn of Egypt was who occupied the senior positions in the priesthood and government, fought a bloody battle with Pharaoh's troop. In an effort to secure the release of the Israelites and prevent the plague of the firstborn, This great miracle is commemorated each year on the Sabbath before Passover, which is therefore called Sabbath Haggadah. The Great Sabbath, this is one of the rare instances in which a commemorative date in the Jewish calendar is set by the day of the week rather than the day of the month. Feast ended in Shushan, Nisan 8, 366 BCE. The grand 180-day feast hosted by King Ahasuerus came to an end on this day. Ahasuerus miscalculated the start date of Jeremiah's prophecy, which promised the rebuilding of the Holy Temple after 70 years of Babylonian exile. When, according to his calculation, the 70 years have passed and the Jews were not redeemed, he orchestrated this grand party to celebrate the demise of the chosen nation. During the course of the party, he brazenly displayed many of the vessels looted from the Holy Temple by the Babylonian armies. Shabbat Shalom.
Shabbat Shalom. This is Ed in Tampa. Priestly versus holiness standards in the Torah. In biblical studies, Leviticus chapters 17 through 26 are usually termed the holiness code, or H. The assumption is that these chapters constitute the earliest level of the priestly source. So Leviticus 17 to 26 is the usually termed holiness. They're part of the priestly source. Simply put, the whole Torah is comprised of four main sources or groups of individuals responsible for the composition and transmission of sources. That is the oral tradition or the written composition. The four sources are generally the J, the E, the D, and the P. The J is kind of a misnomer because it's really Yahweh, but you know, they use the J in Europe. So it's really the Yahweh source, and E is the Elohim, Elohist source. D is Deuteronomy, and P is the priestly source. The priestly source is Genesis through Numbers, of which the holiness code, Leviticus 17 to 26, is part of. The J and the E sources are primarily to the northern kingdom, and there were probably one source commonly known as the J and E source. Before we begin, let's go over a few of our terms from last week, because some of the terms in Leviticus can be a bit difficult. We had the term last week of Tazria, that Strong's H 20 through 2232, which means she conceived or she became pregnant, a Zara. That was also produced a form of impurity. And the two key words we need to continue with always is Tahar and Tamai, or a state of Tahara or Tumah. Tahar being ritually pure, Tamai being ritually impure. And as Pastor says, just remember Tumah with the M in the middle stands for mess or the messy. So ritually impure, it's Tamai or Tamai. Strong's H6879 is another word we had. It was Tisara. That was the B disease of the skin. Also another word is Strong's H6883, Sarat, or skin ailment. This week we're dealing with Mitzora, the person afflicted with Zaraat. That means a leper. However, we're not talking about a leper as we think of leprosy today. And finally, one of the most important terms is Lashon Hara, or the evil tongue, which we don't pay much attention to in our biblical understanding. But God puts a lot of emphasis on Lashon Hara, and that Miriam was stricken with leprosy when she spoke Lashon Hara against her brother. Our parasha this week is about leprosy. Mitzora can be divided into three distinct but related sections. Part one is Leviticus 14, 1 through 32. It picks up from the previous parasha, Tazara. And the key verse in Tazara from last week that it picks up from is Leviticus 13, 46. Leviticus 13, 46 says from our last week's reading, as for the person with the leprous affliction, he shall be unclean as long as the disease is on him. Being unclean, he shall dwell apart. His dwelling should be outside the camp. So how do you deal with a person with leprosy? You put him, that person, outside of the camp. So Parasha Tazara, which discusses the rituals surrounding those found to have various skin ailments. Someone afflicted with Zaraat was considered Tamai, that is ritually impure, and was temporarily banished from the community. That was Leviticus 13:46, which we just read. Mitzorah outlines the rituals of purification for a person who is found to be by the priest to be free from Zaraat. We're told in detail about the process and the rituals by which a person may again become part of the general population once he or she is considered tahor or ritually pure. So part two is Leviticus 14, 33 to 57. This discusses in a similar detail what happens when a house develops a scaly outbreaks on its walls or elsewhere. Remember we said last week that this cannot be leprosy as we know it today, because it can also break out in a house. It can break out in people, clothing, or in a house. So this discusses what happens in the house when a scaly outbreaks in the walls or elsewhere. As with a person, there's a quarantine process. No one may enter the house, and specific rituals are outlined for declaring the house tahor once the scaly growth has been permanently removed. In the case of a home that could not be rid of the outbreak, the entire structure is destroyed. Part three, Leviticus 15, 1 through 33, tells us that genital discharges from men or women, abnormal discharges, normal seminal emissions, and menstruation also make one tamai. The laws concerning the ways in which people with discharges or emissions can return to a tahor state are specified. So according to our commentary from the Jewish Study Bible, on Leviticus 14, 1 through 32, which resumes again from Leviticus 13, 46, these verses describe the steps required of a person cured to dispose of the impurity he has created, both anthropologically, that's the group, the individual level, and sociologically at the group level. These rituals have been seen as a rite of passage marking the return of the outcast to a normal life in human society and back into God's presence. So once again, remember the presence of God is always here in terms of these lessons we've been having for the last week. So purity and impurity has to do with being in the presence of God. If you're impure, they put you out of the camp. So reading further, Mitzorah opens by describing the purification process and accompanying sacrifices for one inflicted with Zaraat, a discoloration of the skin condition of the skin. It describes the process of treating the house as factory with Zaraat and with ritual impurity generated by certainly bodily discharges. Some commentators see leprosy as a result of a spiritual illness. It is an external growth that signifies something that is amiss on the inside. That's very important in understanding the way the Bible looks at leprosy. There's something spiritually wrong in the inside, and it's actually seen on the outside in your skin or in the house. It is a kind of a picture of Dorian Gray phenomenon. When you look, what you look like reflects who you are. Discussion of parashat language and the otherness of both outcasts and lepers and even the Kohanim and their role as a result of health inspectors. Mitzorah generally revolves around one or two topics: the horrendous disease of leprosy as the punishment for lashon hara or harmful language. We realized that about a month ago in our society, we have a huge outbreak of discussion over an incident of lashon hara, when one person said something and his words caused harm to another individual, and there was a reaction to it, and all the world decided on one side or the other. But we saw clearly that was a case of lashon hara. When one speaks evil about another person, or one speaks words that causes harm to another person, that's a case of lashon hara. Once again, when Miriam spoke about her brother Moses, God put leprosy upon her, and her punishment was leprosy for lashon hara. So both outcast lepers and even the Kohanim and their role as health inspectors, the parasha itself addresses the most immediate issues pertaining to the treatment and containment of Zaraat and eruptive skin disease. Somebody or something has it, and now with the priest's assistance, he or she must get rid of it in order to regain social admittance. In this portion of the Torah specifies the detailed rites of purification for a person who is cured of skin disease of Zaraat. The priest dips his finger in the blood of the sacrificial animal and places it on the right ear, the right thumb, and the big toe. Leviticus 14, 14. The priest shall take some of the blood of the trespass offering, and the priest shall put it on the tip of the right ear, him is to be clean, and the thumb of the right hand, and the big toe of the right foot. It is possible this verse says that one who is being cleansed needed blood to be applied to the three places that represent the sin that brought the Zareth. If he allowed his ears to listen to Lashon Hara, gossip, evil speech about another person, allowed his hand to take part of a game that it should not have, or let his foot go where it should not have, then he is struck with Zareth. Therefore, he had to be cleansed in these three places of the body, the ear, the right ear, the right thumb, and the right toe. Remember, Yeshua said, if your eye offend you, pluck it out. Early in Leviticus, we read about how Aaron's sons, the people, are leading and cleansing ritual in our portion, are consecrated as priests. The consecration of the priest involved the identical ritual. That identical ritual is found in Leviticus 8, 23 to 24. Leviticus 8, 23 to 24. He, Moses, brought forth the second ram, that is the ram of ordination, and it was slaughtered. Moses took some of the blood and put it on the ridge of Aaron's ear and on the thumb of his right hand and on the big toe of his right foot. Moses then brought forth the sons of Aaron and repeated the process and dashed the blood against every side of the altar. On my side, on Mount Sinai, before the revelation of the Torah, our people received what could be called the first commandment. You shall be to me a kingdom of priests. Now, that is the first commandment to the nation of Israel. We know that the first commandment back in the garden was to be fruitful and go and multiply. So we're talking about, you shall be to me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation, Exodus 19:6. In the biblical image of the ideal world, the entire nation is consecrated to the task of priesthood. That's in the ideal world. What are the special tasks of the priesthood? It's not just service in the temple and facilitation of the sacrificial service. The priests are the special representatives of God's presence. Our portion describes the responsibility of the priests who are the other or outside. When it's been reported to the priest should go outside the camp, Leviticus 14, 2 to 3. Those who are outside, those who are marginalized, are the others, are physically met and escorted back to community. The priest cannot rely on hearsay or wait on those who are outside the camp to come in. The priest is to go out and meet them where they are. What did Jesus do? He went out and he met them where they are. Just a little quick review. The priests are the special representatives of God's presence. So we're talking about the priest does not just serve in the temple, facilitate sacrificial services. They are also required to go out and meet that person outside the camp. The rite of restoring the leper into the community that the priest used as the familiar one is the same ritual that Moses employed to consecrate the priest, which we just read in Leviticus 8, 23 to 24. Initially, the ritual was used as a marker of the priest's differentness. Here's the same ritual used as a priest to bring a person outside of the camp back into the community. The identical ritual is used to highlight the paradox of the priest's responsibility. The priest becomes other, an outsider, so he goes outside of the camp to fulfill the task of bringing in those who are already outsiders. That's what we should do in our evangelical duties. We should go outside the camp to bring those who are outsiders into the camp. Leviticus 15 provides a set of instructions of how to handle the impurities that results from various male and female genital emissions. Verses 19 to 23 deal with menstruation. When a woman has a discharge, or discharge being blood from her body, she shall remain in her impurity 7 days. Whoever touches her body shall be unclean until evening. Normal menstruation makes a woman impure for 7 days, an amount of time that is both religiously significant and approximately that of an average menstrual period. During her impurity, a woman contaminates anything she sits or lies on, and anyone who touches her or anything she sits or lies on become impure until evening. Leviticus 15, 24. And if a man lies with her, her impurity is communicated to him. He shall be unclean 7 days, and any bedding on which he lies shall become unclean. This verse treats sex with a menstruating woman as the same as a special case of physical contact. Whereas other types of physical contacts result in short-term impurity until evening, a man who has sex with a menstruating woman becomes impure for 7 days and contaminates any bedding that he lies on. A menstrual impurity is communicated to him, and he enters a ritual state of a menstruating woman. Now, these following paragraphs, as we begin to close out, if she said, if you had questions, save them for her. I can't answer any of this, but this is what the Bible says and what the reading says. Okay, beginning, let's go. It is important to bear in mind that the priestly system does not prohibit becoming impure. Keep that in mind. Impurity is seen as a normal part of life. Though impure people may not approach the tabernacle or have any contact with holy things. While this verse states that sex with a menstruating woman results in impurity, ritual impurity, it does not prohibit it. So once again, this verse states that sex with a menstruating woman results in ritual impurity, but it is not prohibited in this particular verse that we're talking about now. There are, however, two verses in the Torah that explicitly prohibit sex with a menstruating woman. Leviticus 18:19 reads, Leviticus 18:19, do not come near a woman during the period of uncleanness to uncover her nakedness. Leviticus 20:18 adds a punishment to this prohibition. Leviticus 20:18, if a man lies with a woman in her infirmity and uncovers her nakedness, he has laid bare her flow and she has exposed her blood flow, both of them shall be cut off from among the people. In both verses, the prohibition is clear and unambiguous. Leviticus 20:18 even penalizes with the couple with the severe penalty of karat. Karat is Strong's H3772. Karat is not only found in Strong's, it is a very, very strong prohibition. It means cut off. It means eliminate, kill, or destroy. So it means you're cut off from the community. So once again, Leviticus 20:18, if a man lies with a woman with her infirmity and uncovers her nakedness, he has laid bare her flow, and she has exposed her blood flow, both of them shall be cut off from among their people. In both verses, the prohibition is clear and unambiguous. Leviticus 20:18 even penalizes the couple with the severe penalty of karat, being cut off from their people. If sex with a menstruating woman is so severely prohibited, why is it not mentioned in Leviticus 15:24? Save your questions. Through the ages, there have been various explanations to what seems to be a contradiction in scriptures. One suggested Leviticus 15:24 deals with a case in which the woman's period started during intercourse, so the contamination is accidental and unintentional. Another maintains that the prohibition is not mentioned because it is simply not the subject of the verse, which deals with ritual impurity and not sexual transgression. A broader look at Leviticus 15 favors the view that this chapter considers sex with a menstruating woman permissible. The chapter concerns impurity from a variety of male and female emissions, most of which are involuntary and just cannot logically be prohibited. You can't control your bodily function. That's what your body does, so you can't prohibit it. Sex with a menstruate is treated as fundamentally similar to other cases of contact with polluting people of emissions, none of which are prohibited. Let's look finally at my final commentary from the JPS Study Bible. That commentary is found in Leviticus 15, commentary verses 1 through 33. Impurity from bodily discharges, concluding the laws of purification from bodily impurities. This chapter deals with defilement caused by the flow of life fluids from genital organs, semen, menstrual fluid, and discharge accompanying various urethral infections or gonorrhea. They are treated as facts of nature, some normal, some not abnormal. The only sin connected with them is the failure to purify oneself from them. So finally, these two different approaches to the subject comes from different state of strata of Torah, each of which derives from the distinct priestly school. Leviticus 15 comes from the priestly source, but the verses that prohibit sex with menstruants come from the holiness school of legislation. The following elements distinguish the P, or the priestly text, from the holiness text. The holiness text is Israelite-centered versus P, which is priest-centered. P as the whole is primarily concerned with the priesthood, the laws of the tabernacle, and ritual impurity. H, however, includes laws that deal with a wide variety of issues relevant to Israelite life. One addresses Israel versus Moses, where God speaks to Moses through the priestly legislation. In the holiness legislation, God tends to address Israel more personally in the second person plural, rather than in the third person. And in the laws and in holiness are often punctuated by the expression, I am the Lord, I am the Lord your God, which serve as a source of divine signature. Number three, focus on the holiness of Israel, that is the H of holiness. As its name suggests, the holiness legislation places a strong emphasis on holiness. The remainder of the priest is concerned with holiness, particularly that of the priest and the tabernacle. But the holiness is specifically concerned with the holiness of the Israelite people. The Israelites are commanded to be holy because their God is holy, and they are to accomplish this by obeying God's laws that are found in holiness. 1 Peter 1:15, but he has called you is holy, be so ye holy in all manner of conversation, because it is written, be holy, for I am holy. Priestly versus holiness standards in the Torah, Shabbat Shalom. Save your questions. Leroy?
Oh, I'm sorry, I was unmuted. Shabbat Shalom. All praises to Yahweh. Ed, I think you answered all the questions, Ed. That was good information. Okay, leprosy in the Gospels. Yahweh has made his dwelling with the children of Israel. His sanctified presence demands that the children of Israel live consecrated lives. That's us, y'all. The earthly sanctuary can become impure through the ritual and cleanliness of the children of Israel. In order to avoid this, they need to know all the rules that show them what produces uncleanliness and how they can be free from it. This is why in Leviticus chapter 11 through 15, the Torah unfolds a thorough teaching about ritual uncleanliness. By fulfilling these rules, the people can count where the presence of the eternal dwells. Chapter 11 speaks about the prohibition of eating unclean animals. The type of uncleanness that is produced by this cannot be removed by cleansing rituals and is therefore more serious than the others. When someone touches the corpse of an unclean animal, ritual uncleanness is produced in the person. This type of uncleanness, however, can be removed through cleansing rituals. Chapter 12 speaks about the uncleanness that is produced in a woman who gives birth. Chapter 13 speaks about the uncleanness produced by the affliction of Zarah, which is translated leprosy. Chapter 14 speaks about how to be cleansed from Zarah and how to treat a house that has the same affliction. In chapter 15, we find the teaching about the ritual uncleanness produced by the fluids that comes from the reproductive organs of men and women. All these instructions were given in order to avoid that the tabernacle became unclean and the people harmed by the presence of Yahweh. This applied during the desert wanderings as well as when the people entered the promised land. The rules about ritual uncleanness have to do with consecration in relation to the physical presence of Yahweh within the people of Israel in the tabernacle as long as there is no temple. We cannot keep the laws that have to do with sacrifices, but it is perfectly achievable to keep the laws about not eating unclean animals and purifying our bodies in a mikvah. The Jewish people continue to keep the instructions about ritual purity that apply even though there is no temple, because they are still a consecrated people. So, and that's a good point, because that's something that we have to do. A couple of weeks ago, we talked about how the priests prepared themselves and the rituals that they did in order for Yahweh to dwell in their presence. So they understood that, look, even though I'm a priest, you know, Yahweh, I'm not gonna hear from Yahweh. He's not gonna speak to me. I'm not going to be able to give his word to the people to guide them and their children if I'm not consecrated. You understand? So that's what we have to do as well. We have to consecrate ourselves from the rest of the world. We have to understand that the Holy Spirit is not going to dwell in an unclean temple. So in order, the Holy Spirit is our source of revelation. It gives us wisdom. It gives us power. It intercedes for us. Even when we're going through difficult times and we can't pray for ourselves, the Bible says that the Spirit intercedes for us and pray for us. Because we have those moments, but if we don't consecrate ourselves and create a space that the Most High can dwell in, we're not privy to these privileges. You know, so we have to make sure that we consecrate ourselves, set ourselves apart. Everybody's choosing a side. Look at the world. Everybody's choosing a side, what direction they want to go. So we got to make sure we follow that straight and narrow path and consecrate ourselves from the rest of the world. Now, the Torah teaches that we are to make a distinction between that which is Tahor and that which is Tamai. Understanding these distinctions is critical to our ability to keep and do the Torah. It is unfortunate that the English translators of the Bible have translated these two words as clean and unclean. The distinction of clean and unclean seems to imply that if we simply wash the dirt off of something, then it will be clean. But as we have already seen, even if you give a pig a bath, it is still unclean. The Torah distinctions that we are to make in our lives will make more sense if we understand the distinction between Tahor and Tamai. In the Torah, leprosy is an archetype for all human sickness. Sickness results from the breakdown of the flesh. Death follows. Leprosy graphically represents that progression. In God's eternal sanctuary, there is no sickness, no death, and no decay. His sanctuary on earth is meant to be a reflection of that eternal reality. Therefore, lepers are banned from the sanctuary. He shall remain unclean all the days which he has the infection. He is unclean. He shall live alone. His dwelling shall be outside the camp. Leviticus 13:46. Why was this healing of lepers such a central concern in the ministry of the master? Not only did he heal many lepers himself, but he gave his 12 disciples authority to heal leprosy as evidence of the kingdom of heaven, Matthew 10. Aside from leprosy, no other human disease or ailment renders a person ritually unclean. So why is leprosy associated with uncleanness? The symptoms described in the Torah that might potentially be diagnosed as biblical leprosy involves decomposition, decay, and putrefaction, corruption of the flesh. The temple worship system seems to shun corruption and decay. In keeping with that tendency, the Torah commands that the flesh of the sacrifices must be burned up after 2 days. If the sacrificial meat is allowed to turn rancid, the entire sacrifice is invalidated. The same impulse towards incorruptibility lies behind the laws of the grain offering. The grain offerings are all made without leaven. Leaven represents corruption because the leavening process is actually a fermentation of the dough. For the same reason, the sacrifices were all salted. We are the salt. Salt is a preservation which slows down the decomposition process. So as we know, we got to stay away from that leaven. We're going to be talking about that pretty soon. We have the Passover coming up and the Feast of Unleavened. But in a little leaven, unleaveneth the whole lump, leavened the whole lump. So that is another consecration there, the leaven and the unleavened. So we have to make sure we stay separated. You know, Yahweh always want to keep us separated. He know that we live in a world full of everything. You know, oftentimes it's hard to avoid people when you go certain places that they're involved in certain things. But he always wanted to keep his people separated. Because when he bring down judgment upon the earth or what have you, he want to make sure his people are protected. And that's why when we was talking about, I think last Shabbat, about the unclean meats, to where the children of Israel, they had their own societies because they didn't want to do that social mixing. So we didn't mix with other nations. So we had our own restaurants, our own clean meats. We didn't dwell with other nations, because once you do that social mixing, then you start adapting other things. Hey, what about this? What about that? And he wanted to keep us away from that. He didn't, that's why he didn't want the men dealing with strange women. Look what happened to Solomon. That's social mixing, and now he's building temples for false gods. So is it, so we have to be careful that we consecrate ourselves in all things. Now, God's sanctuary is about immortality and incorruptibility. In his presence, there's no death, no decay, no decomposition. Therefore, the disease that represents a living decomposition is banned from the sanctuary. Leprosy is an ongoing visible progression towards physical corruption. It is the antithesis of the immortal and incorruptible word representing in God's sanctuary. Yeshua is the solution to the leprosy problem. Spiritually, he did not suffer the leprosy-like infection of sin. Physically, his flesh did not suffer corruption. But for you will not abandon my soul to Sheol, nor will you allow your Holy One to undergo decay. Psalm 16:10 prophesies about him. Through his resurrection from the dead, his flesh passed from the mortal to the immortal, from the corruptible to the incorruptible. His body is still real human flesh, but it is regenerated as an imperishable spiritual body. Leprosy symbolizes the sin laden human condition, destined for death and decay. Each time the master healed a leper, it betokened a reversal of the corrupted mortal state. Every leper healed of his affliction was a testimony that the kingdom of heaven and indeed appeared, had indeed appeared among men. Now, baptizo. The New Testament tells several stories about people being baptized, but the stories do not spell out the details of how the baptism was accomplished. The apostolic writers thought that the method and procedure of baptism was so well known that they felt no compulsion to record any of the details of the ritual, because the apostles were all Jews. They considered baptism to be a basic part of daily life, which required no description. So they didn't dig deep into the baptism, because everybody kept the law, and they knew what was clean and unclean, what the mikvah was for. But we also have to keep in mind what we read about earlier. You can wash your pig, and that doesn't mean it's unclean. So having a mikvah and being baptized does not save you. So don't be like the Pharisees, thinking because you're following these rituals and everything that you're holier than thou and that you're saved, because you're not. It is ritual cleanliness. That's why John the Baptist was baptizing with water, but Christ came to baptize with the Spirit. So once we have that Spirit dwelling within us, and we're consecrated, allowing that Holy Spirit to dwell within us, now we're on the right track. So let's not get tied up in the rituals thinking that's going to purify us and get us to the Most High. Still a lot of work to do after that. Now, baptism was originally a Levitical purification rite. Most purification ceremonies, such as the purification after leprosy, require immersion into a mikvah. The Greek New Testament expresses immersion into the mikvah with the term baptizo, the word from which we derive the English term baptism. Leviticus 15 prescribes baptism as the mode of purification for a variety of ritual contamination. Baptism means different things to different forms of Christianity. Disagreements about the mode and the meaning of baptism can be blamed in part on the New Testament's scanty descriptions of the ritual. The apostles say very little about the mode, never explaining exactly how a person is to be baptized. They say a bit more about the symbolism, but they leave most of that as if it is already taken for granted. A person needs to be ritually pure before he or she can enter the sanctuary or eat of the sacrifices. At a minimum, purification from ritual uncleanness require a full body immersion into a Mayim Kayim, living water, that is water collected from a natural source, like a spring, a river, or rainwater, but not drawn from a cistern or a well. A pool of living water is called a mikvah. A person undergoing immersion descends into the mikvah, or river, or lake, or ocean, or whatever the case may be. The person immerses himself or herself by wading into chest deep water and bending the knees to completely submerge himself or herself. The dunking is repeated two or more times for a total of three consecrated dunks. A person who is immersed himself in the manner washed away all ritual uncleanness. All worshipers going up to the temple underwent immersion before entering the holy place. Archaeology has unearthed the remains of many apostolic era immersion facilities near the entrance to the temple. These are the same immersion baths that Yeshua and his disciples used as they went up to the temple when in Jerusalem. Archaeologists have found remains of apostolic era immersion baths all over the land of Israel, and they consider the presence of a mikveh in an excavation as key evidence of a Jewish population. All of this indicates that baptism was not a Christian invention or even apostolic innovation, excuse me. From the days of Noah, Jews regularly practiced ritual immersion. Anyone who became ritually unclean needed to undergo a baptism before he or she could enter the temple or eat from the sacrifices. The priests immersed every day. After a woman completed her monthly cycle, she needed to immerse herself before she could rejoin her husband. Some pious Pharisees went beyond the letter of the law and attempted to maintain a constant state of ritual purity, which necessitated regular daily immersion. They're the Pharisees. They're always overdoing something, but their heart wasn't right. The immersion ritual symbolizes death and resurrection. When a proselyte converts to Judaism to become legally Jewish, he passes through an immersion in the mikveh. His legal identity as a Gentile dies in the water of the mikveh, and the proselyte emerges from the mikveh reborn as a Jew. Likewise, John the Immerser employed immersion as a physical token of repentance. The penitent entering the water of the Jordan died to sin and emerged from water reborn to a life of repentance and righteousness. Paul attached similar symbolism to the immersion in Messiah. Do you know that all of us who have been baptized into Messiah Yeshua have been baptized into his death? Our old self was crucified with him in order that our body of sin might be done away with, so that we would no longer be slaves to sin, for who has died is freed from sin. And it is Romans 6, 3 through 7. Shabbat shalom.
Shabbat shalom, Shabbat shalom. Ed, you able to close this out, sir?
I thought you were going to take questions.
Oh, no, sir.
Lord God, we just thank you, Father God, for the word you've given us. We thank you, Lord, that we faithfully gathered today, Lord, where Moses is read, Father. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your mercy, and we thank you for your time you've spent with us. Father God, as we continue this day, set aside to you your Sabbath, Father God. Lord, we just thank as we repeat the opening prayer, Lord, for peace. Peace in your holy city of Jerusalem, Lord. And peace, Lord God, in those countries that are experiencing war, Father God. We pray for peace, Lord God. We pray that you intervene, Lord, so that women and children and family members and senior people aren't killed, Father. We're just thanking, Lord God, you've given us this time, this space of peace. We thank you, Lord. We pray for all those sick, Lord, for all those who are on the various prayer lists for healing, Father. We lift our prayers up to you, Father God. We just thank you, Father, that you're our Father, you're our Lord, you're our King, you're our God, Father, you're our all in all. We thank you for salvation. We thank you for saving faith. We thank you that you empower us to go outside the camp and bring those in, Lord God, who need to be restored, who need to come back into fellowship with you, Father God. We just thank you, Father, you've exposed us to Torah, Father. We thank you, Lord, that you redeemed the time. Father God, we just thank you, Lord, that every day in Torah is another day in our life, Father. We thank you, Lord, for this season, Father God, this year, this Jubilee year, Lord, this year of restoration, this year, Lord God, that we grow even more in your name. We thank you, Lord, that this time marks the beginning of the months for us. We thank you, Father, for a new life, a new beginning in your teaching and instruction. Now, Lord, I pray, Father God, as we continue about our duties this day, that we keep you, Father, in mind and thought and in deed. That we live lives according to your Torah, your teaching and instruction. Father, help us have clean minds, Lord. Help us to mikvah our thinkings, our bodies, our thoughts, our practices. Help us, Lord, not to go and to do sin, not to listen to evil things, not to do evil things with our hands or with our feet. Thank you, Lord, this day. Bless our pastor. We thank you for this word. We pray for the missions, Lord, over in Sierra Leone and the juvenile facility, Lord, everywhere you bless us to go. Father God, thank you, Father, for enabling us and empower us to do your will. In Jesus' name, we thank you and we pray. Thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord. Amen and amen.